start with the revision of the points road not taken as well as first of all the poem road not taken. So who has written road not taken? The name of the poet is Robert Frost. Robert Frost is the poet of nature, and Robert Frost has presented a very, you can say, important problem or important process of our life. What he has brought about? He has brought about the process of decision making. That it is a very important process in our life, and sometimes we are in dilemma, we are in confusion, okay, whichever decision we should make, and he has signified it with the help of roads. Okay, so let us see the paraphrasing of the poem. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry, I could not travel both. So what the poet is saying? Poet is saying that he was standing in a yellow wood, means autumnal season was there, and the yellow leaves, they what they show? They show old people, okay, poor experienced ones, right? He was standing, it means that it is a symbolic of, right? Okay, that it is a symbolic of old age people who were experienced enough, who have passed through different situations of life, and they have gained a lot of experience. So the poet is saying that he was standing in a yellow wood on a diverse road. Diverse road means where the road, it is bifurcating into two. And sorry, I could not travel both. The poet is showing his incapability as a human being, that he is not able to travel both the roads at one time. Okay. So why he is not able to travel both the roads at one time? Because of the reason why he is not able to travel both the roads at one time. Yes, he can only make one decision at a time. Okay. So this is the reason why he is not able to travel both the roads at one time. Okay. So moreover, the poet is saying that being a human, he should have taken only one path, either the left one or the right one, but he is not able to travel both the roads simultaneously and at one time. And be one traveler, long I stood. Be one traveler, because he is a single traveler who could take only one road. And he said that for long time I stood there. Okay, for long time I stood there to think, to visualize my decision that which road I should take. And looked down one as far as I could. And he said, I looked as far as my eye could have reached in order to see that whichever road I should take. Okay. To where it bent in an undergrowth. Finally, till the last point where my eyesight could reach, the road it is bending into an undergrowth. What is undergrowth means? Like bushes or group of trees which have formulated a cluster there. Okay. So it was bending into an undergrowth. So here in the first stanza, the poet is saying about his incapability that one has to make only one decision. Here roads are symbolic of the various decisions which we have to take. Now, then I took the other just as fair and having the better, perhaps the better claim. So then the poet said, afterwards, I took the other road. Okay. What he has done, that he has taken the other road, and he thought that the other road was just as fair as the previous one. It means that it seems to be like that it was as inviting as the previous one. It has that kind of claim as it was in the previous road, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Grassy and wanted wear is an example of personification as well as alliteration. Okay. And having perhaps the better claim, he thought that the other road would prove to be a better prospect for him. It would be a better answer to his questions. It would prove good results for him. Okay, so what he thought that he should take the other road, which was grassy and wanted bare. Grassy means it was covered with grass. Wanted bare means that someone has not traveled over it. Okay, it needs to be torn. Okay, it needs to be worn out. Okay, because it is afresh. Okay, the grass is as fresh as it has just, you can say, sprouted out, and no one has traveled over that road. Though as for that passing there,
had warned them really about the same. But as I have passed through that road, then the poet said, I have come to know that this road is also worn like that of the previous one. But when he has come to know about it, when he has traveled on that road. Okay, so again I repeat that which road he has chosen. He has chosen the less traveled road. Why he has chosen that road? Because it was grassy. It was less traveled by people. So he thought that maybe this road, which is not chosen by many people, this would prove to be a better claim for him. Okay, so for that reason, he has chosen that road. But when he has passed on to that road, what happened? Then he has also come to know that this road is equally traveled by people. It has been worn out in the same manner as previously. Okay, and both that morning equally lay. So now he is again coming to the point of that morning when he is standing on the diverged road. Okay, so while he was standing on the diverged road, what he is saying? And on that morning, so when he is standing on that diverged road, what he is saying on that morning, both the roads, they were lying in front of me in an equal situation. Okay, equally. And in leaves, no step had trodden black. So what is the meaning of this? In leaves, no step had trodden black. It means that, you know, when the leaves, they are trampled under feet. Okay, when someone travels over it, they turn out to be black. The fresh light green color, it changes into dark green color. Okay, so but no leaves, in leaves, no step had trodden black. But it seems that no step had moved over these leaves. And the leaves, they have not turned black, as no step has moved over these leaves. You can just understand it carefully. Oh, I kept the first for another day. But what he said, that I have kept the first road for another day. He thought that this road is a better claim for me, which is a less traveled one, okay? Which is not traveled by many people, okay? Why he thought? He thought that this would prove to be a better claim for him, okay? So now, then what he thought? He thought that the first road, I should keep it for some other day. It means that if he would ever get a chance to come back, he would come back and would travel on that road. So he has kept the other road for some other day. Okay. Yet knowing how way leads on to way. But he knew that he would not be allowed to come back on that road again. Because once you pass through a journey, once you pass through a passage or a, you can say, way, you will never come back. Because one way, then further, it is leading to some other ways and adjoining ways or interlinked ways. So he said, I know that I won't get a chance to come back. I won't be able to come back to take this road again. But I doubt it. I should ever come back. But he said, I was in doubt whether I would be able to come back again or not. But finally, he has to take the decision. So he has taken the decision. And which road he has taken? He has taken the less traveled road. I shall be telling this with a sigh. So after many years, when he has got the outcome of his, you can say, of his decision, what he's saying that now I'm telling this with a sigh. After many years, when I have come to know about the result of my decision, I have come to know, now he's telling this with a sigh. Okay, but this sigh is of what? This sigh can be of happiness. This sigh can be of sadness. Okay, so but we can't interpret it that whether it is of happiness or that of sadness. Okay, so what he said that, but I shall be telling this with a sigh, but I'm telling this with a deep breath, okay, filled with emotions, and somewhere ages and ages hence, and he's telling to other people that many years ago, ages and ages hence means that many years ago, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by. There were two roads who were diverging on a in a forest, and it was an option in front of me that which road I should take. And finally, he said that I have taken the less traveled road, and that has made all the difference in our life. So it means that the process of decision making is very, very important in our life, because at that time when we have to make the decisions, we are not able to get the outcomes, we are not able to get the outreach, okay, we are not able to get the results of that, you can say, decision. But it is with time the decision is justified, whether it is right or wrong. So it means that one should weigh, watch, as well as consider all the aspects of a problem before taking it into consideration. Right? Okay. So your vision test is on
Saturday.
Right. Okay. So syllabus you have got. Right. So I don't think so. Any doubt to any student? Okay. Now, where does the traveler find himself, and what problem does he face? So where he was traveling, he was passing from a in a yellow wood, and what problem he was facing, which road he should take. He was in confusion that which road he should take, okay, because ultimately that would make all the difference in his life. Okay, now what is the meaning of yellow wood? Old people, experienced people. Okay, so which road was taken by the poet?
Less traveled road.
It was the less traveled by. So what is the, how the poet has used symbolism in the poem? So okay, roads as options, decisions in front of him. Okay, right? So you will bring out all the examples of the symbolism used here. Okay, so what does the choice made by the poet indicates about his personality? Which road he has taken?
Less
traveled by. Then what does it tell about the poet?
That
he likes to take risks. He's a risk taker. He's adventurous in nature also. And it is because of this reason that he has taken the road less traveled by. Because he thought that maybe less people has traveled over that road. So maybe this would be a better claim for him. Maybe no, not many have come to know about it. You can say, yes, please, louder. Indecisive. Okay, right. So any problem now in this poem? That's clear. So the next poem today we are going to revise is the poem Wind. Okay, so what does Wind, through Wind poem, what does the poet wants to bring out? First of all, who is the poet? Subramanya Bharati. Okay, so what does the poet want to bring out through this poem? No, through all these examples, what the poet want to deliver? That even nature always, you can say, takes the side of strong people. Even nature or even weak people, they have to face the wrath, wrath, anger of nature. Okay, nature is not, you can say, so you can say calm as well as favorable for weak people. Okay, one who is strong, he can withstand the atrocities of nature, and ultimately only those people will be able to survive. Okay, only those people will be able to survive. So next poem, Wind. So the poet is, first of all, he is, you can say, invoking, yes, to come softly. He's telling the wind to come softly. Don't break the shutters of the windows. Don't scatter the papers. So don't break the shutters of the windows. Don't scatter the papers. This is an example of anaphora. Okay, this is an example of anaphora. What is anaphora? When a word, phrase, okay, or a line, it is repeated in the consecutive lines, or it is repeated in the next coming lines, then it is called as anaphora. Okay, so don't break the shutters of the windows and don't scatter the papers. The poet is saying to the wind that come softly, blow softly, and do not break the shutters of the windows and do not scatter the papers. Don't throw down the books on the shelf, and no, don't blow so strongly that the books which are placed in a tasteful manner, in an arranged manner on the shelf, they should be brought down, they should be thrown down from the shelf. They look what you did. Did you throw them all down? See, now the poet is saying to the wind, look what you can say, what your actions has brought down, what effect it has brought down, that you have brought down all the books from the shelf. You have made everything in distress, and you have made everything, you can say, in an unarranged manner. You tore the pages of the books, you brought rain again. So what you have done, you have torn the pages of the books because of fast blowing of the wind. The pages, they were, you can say, flipping again and again, and it is because of this reason that they were torn again. And you brought rain again because of the blowing of the wind. The clouds gather in the sky, and ultimately it has brought rain again. But this rain, which is always, seems to be of happy ending, or you can say, which is a sort of, you can say, tonic for nature. But this time it is not welcome, which is always welcome, is not welcomed here, because maybe it has produced many disastrous effects. And you are very clever at poking fun at weaklings. So here throughout the poem, personification is used. Okay. So throughout the poem, what is used? Personification is used, right? Personification is used throughout the poem. So what the poet is saying, that see what you have done, and now you are very clever at poking fun at weaklings. It means that the wind is very clever. Why it is clever? To make fun of the weak people. Okay, weak people, they are made fun of by the wind. It means that wind is not favorable towards weak people also. Frail means weak. Crumbling means breaking houses, crumbling doors, crumbling rafters, crumbling woods, crumbling bodies, crumbling lives, crumbling hearts. It means that because of this many materialistic world, the strong blowing wind, it can cause damage to the materialistic world also, but side by side, it is also causing damage to number of people. Many people are dead, and ultimately, because many people, they are attached to the materialistic things also. They are attached to their houses also. And when these houses, they are broken, or their loved ones, they are hurt by the action of the wind, then it is crumbling their hearts. It is affecting their hearts. It means wind is not having its disastrous effect upon the materialistic world or on the things only, but it has its effect on the lives of the people also, that many people, they suffer a lot, okay, because of the strong action of the wind, right? Repetition. Because why it is repetition? Because it is not in the starting only. It's not in starting crumbling is used. Crumbling is used throughout the line. So this is not anaphora, this is repetition. Okay, so the wind god winnows. Here it is again personification, and wind god is the power of wind. So it is a metaphor here. Wind god winnows and crushes them all. It means winnow is the process of separation. Okay, now what the wind god does, because wind is powerful, that this is the reason why it is called as strong god. Okay, it separates. It separates weak from strong people and crushes them all. He won't do what you tell him. Okay, so what he did, he crushes the weak people. Okay, and he is also used for wind. So it is again personification. and what you tell him, and he will never listen to you what you will tell to the wind. So come, let's build strong homes, let's join the doors firmly. So what the poet is saying, let's build strong homes, that we will come and build strong homes, because in order to withstand these effects of wind, what we have to do, we have to build strong homes. We have to be strong enough. We have to make our hearts steadfast. We have to make ourselves strong to stand against the actions of wind, because wind otherwise is quite destructive in nature. But if we want to withstand these forces of nature, we have to be strong enough. And now the poet is, yes, and make our hearts steadfast, right? So come, let's build strong homes. So the poet is giving an advice that in order to evade this action of wind, what we have to do, we have to build strong homes. Strong homes, let's join the doors firmly. And what we have to do, we have to join the doors firmly. We have to join them and practice to form the body. And we will also practice, we will also try to make our bodies firm and strong. Make the heart steadfast. So what we have to do, make our heart strong. It means that in our feelings, in our emotions, we should be strong enough to stand any kind of, you can say jerk that is causing a harm to our heart. So we have to make our hearts steadfast as well as strong. Do this, and wind will be friends with us. If we will be strong enough, then wind will be our friend. Okay, so what it means? It means that the wind will be our friend then. And what we feel that it means that wind is also on the side of strong things and strong people. If we will make our doors and houses strong, wind won't let them fall down. Wind won't be able to crumble it down. Okay, so ultimately they would, you can say, survive the harsh effects of wind. But if we are weak enough, then what will happen? It will cause a lot of harm to them. So, but it means ultimately the poet is saying, you should be strong enough. You should be strong enough to withstand them. Okay, and the wind blows out weak fires. Sorry, do this and wind will be our friends. The wind blows out weak fires and he makes strong fires roar and flourish. So in case of fire also, the weak fires, they are always blown out because of wind. Okay, light a matchstick and blow some wind. Okay, then what it will happen, it will be blown out. Okay, but if forest fires, they can't be controlled with special equipment also. So what it means that wind makes strong fires roar and flourish, and in this manner, this also happens in our lives too. Okay, that wind is ultimately leading. Wind is ultimately leading destruction in our lives if we will be weak enough. But if we will be strong enough, then we can withstand any kind of harsh effect of wind, and we can survive to whatever extent we can. And his friendship is good, and we praise him every day. His friendship is good. It means that if we will utilize its energy, if we will use it wisely, then what will happen? It will be friend of us. It will be more beneficial on our part. And we praise him every day means in the form of deity also. Okay, we praise fire. Okay, but fire is always friend to those who are strong. Wind is friend to only those who are strong enough. So the poet is saying to us to be strong enough to face, to evade its power. Yes, the poet is ultimately delivering the message that we should be mentally strong enough, okay, to face all kinds of difficulties and problems that are happening in our lives. Okay, so this is the poem Wind, and any other doubt if you have, you can ask me. It's fine, it's clear, right? No doubt. Okay. So prepare your test. You know that it will be in the form of a Google form, and it will be a MCQ one. Okay, writing skills will also be there. You will get an idea, okay, that what kind of writing skills can be there. Okay, fine. And apart from it, tomorrow we are going to start with Truly Beautiful Mind. We will revise this book this week, okay, and then afterwards we will start with the next book. Okay, so then afterwards we will take all the grammar topics into consideration, right? So this revision test, you have writing skills. So grammar we have done recently. I don't think so you have any problem. Okay, right? So that's it for today. Okay, in the next lecture we will continue. Okay.